So we're continuing, it's just a two-parter, continuing with where we started last week when we looked at John, the first chapter of John, and picking up near where we left off last time and going a little further this time. So remember, John the Baptist, he's out there, he's baptizing, he's telling people about Jesus. He identifies Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And then the next day, verse 35, the next day John was there again with two of his disciples. How many disciples did he have? We don't know, but he had two with him this day. And when he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." And when these two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Makes sense, right? Hey, he's the Lamb of God. He's the one who is to come. We ought to be following him. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" And they said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" Because remember last week we said it's about a place, right? "Where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 p.m. I find John interesting. John's the one that gives us all these interesting details. 4 p.m. It was the ninth hour. Remember at the resurrection, they got 186 fish. You know, I mean, who counts them? But John did, you know, and he gives us that detail. And then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. And the first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ. And he, Andrew, brought him, Simon, to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John." How does he know that? I don't know. Well, I do know. He's Jesus, right? "You are Simon, son of God, John. You will be called Cephas," which is an Aramaic word, Simon Peter in Aramaic, which translated is Peter, which, as you know, Peter means rock, right? And later on, when they're at one of the places where there's a lot of pagan ritual going on, he is named Peter. "And on this rock I will build my church," Jesus says. So you remember all of that, and all of that comes into play in this story. So the Olympics have just ended a couple of 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago maybe. How many watched? Anybody? We did, yeah, you did. Some of us did, some of us didn't. Viewership was down by 42%. Can you believe it? I mean, at a time when people still feel the need to be home, but evidently they had better things to watch. But one of the stories that I saw that I really loved was the story of faith. Maybe not all these stories were told. I heard some of them. Maybe you did as well. Turns out a lot of Team USA is also on Team Jesus. Praise the Lord. And they're not afraid to say so, including Sydney McLaughlin. Have you heard about this gal? She was the first woman ever to break 52 seconds in the 400-meter hurdles. I can't believe how fast some of these people can be. She set a new world record at the U.S. Olympic trials in June, and then she broke that record in Tokyo. But what is the best about her, in my humble opinion, is her faith. And she said this when she won the gold. She said, "What I have in Christ is far better than what I have or don't have in life. I pray my journey may be a clear depiction of submission and obedience to God." Isn't that beautiful? That, praise the Lord. And then there's a 19-year-old runner, Aething Mu, I think is how she says it. She won the gold in the 800 meters, a race, not a hurdles, and she set a new U.S. record, and she was the first U.S. woman to win since 1968. But again, this is what she said. "As a follower of Christ, our main goal is to live in the image of Jesus." Now, you might have heard this story, because this gal, Alice and Felix got quite a bit of publicity. She's been in 5 Olympics. She's won 11 medals, which is the most ever for an American in track and field. And if you were watching, they made a big deal about her being 35 and a mother. Now, her child is a few years old now, so it's not that she was pregnant at 35, though that would be okay too. But what you didn't hear, and I'm sure you didn't hear, is the price that she had to pay. So when Ms. Felix became pregnant, Nike, her number one sponsor, wanted her to have an abortion. But her and her husband decided to choose life for their daughter, Cameron. And when they did, Nike withdrew 70% of their sponsorship money. So you can imagine, that's how these athletes survive, right, on sponsorship money. But it was never a question for Allison. She said this, "I feel so blessed that God has given me the talent of running, and I want to use it to the best of my ability to glorify Him." Praise the Lord. And there were other stories about faith as well. We can't go through them all. But these athletes, you see, they have this worldwide stage on which to share their faith. And good for them. They were bold to do so. But we began last Sunday talking about Back to Church Sunday, and that's our chance. That's not a worldwide stage, but it is a stage nonetheless to share our faith, whether it's with our next door neighbor or some family member or, you know, 2 or 3 of our friends or whatever. And really not even to share the faith. It's not necessarily about that. It can be, but it doesn't have to be. But really just to do what Jesus did. Remember that saying was everywhere, you know, 10, 20 years ago. What? WWJD. What would Jesus do? He'd invite someone to Back to Church Sunday, which is thus 3 weeks away, September 19th. That's why I'm saying it now, because I want to give you plenty of time to pray and to share with someone, to invite someone to come with you. So we started last week, and we looked at this story in John's Gospel. And John is there identifying Jesus as the Lamb of God, and then one of those disciples, Andrew, comes up to Jesus, and Jesus invites him to come to see, right? He says, "Where are you staying?" And Jesus says, "Come on, come on, come on, I'll show you." Andrew and somebody else that remains nameless. But you see, that's all that we're doing for Back to Church Sunday. All we're doing is saying, "Hey, come and see. I want to show you something. You know, come to my church just this one Sunday." We're not asking somebody to get baptized. We're not asking them to make a lifelong commitment or join the church. We're just saying, come and see. Because that's what Jesus does. And for that matter, that's what Jesus did for you and me, isn't it? He just invited us initially to come and see. And Jesus invites them, these two disciples. And when he does, they accept his invitation. They came and saw. Verse 39, so they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they spent that day with him. They accepted our Lord's invitation to come and see. And that's all we're doing. And that's, I'll tell you what, people will accept your invitation too. Especially when you say, "Oh, it's just this one Sunday. We're having this Back to Church Sunday, you know. Won't you come? We're just getting together. We're inviting some friends. I wonder if you'd like to come with me." And guess what? Somebody will say yes. You might have to ask 2 or 3, 5 people, whatever. But somebody will say yes. Because remember those statistics from last week. Folks basically are waiting. They're welcoming of such invitations. But there's one statistic I didn't mention last week. And maybe I don't like it, but it might be the most important statistic. And that is 100%. 100%. 100% of the folks that you or I do not invite, 100% of them probably won't come. They probably won't come. But they might if you or if I invite them. So we can do what Jesus did, right? We can talk to somebody about Jesus. And Jesus begins slowly, right? In John's Gospel, at least, he starts with Andrew. and this other guy. And look at verse 41. What's the first thing that Andrew does after he goes to see who Jesus is and where he's staying in that? It says, the first thing he did was to find his brother Simon and tell him. Now think about that. That's a key verse. Because what it's saying is, he's talking to somebody he knows, right? He's talking to his own family member, his own flesh and blood. He's inviting someone he knows. Because I don't know if Andrew knows this or not, but it will raise the stakes of being successful, right? We talk to somebody we know. We go up to somebody on the street corner and say, hey, you know, why don't you come with the church with me? Who are you? You know, it's what the reaction we might get. But you talk to somebody you know. I'm talking to friends. I'm talking to people I know. I hope you are as well. You talk to somebody you know, and there's a good chance that they'll come. Because think about it. We are the Andrews, right? We are the Andrews. We came. We saw. You know, we've spent a few days with Jesus. Some of us a few years, a few decades with Jesus. And now we get to do the inviting. Think about that for a minute. Think about who invited you, right? Was it any of these dear saints maybe that invited you? Maybe one of them was your Sunday school teacher. Maybe one of them was a family member who invited you. Maybe it was your mom or dad. That's how it was for me, right? I came to church this way the first time, and my kids did as well. But who invited you to come to church? And just take a moment and picture that person in your mind's eye and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for this Andrew in my life, right? Anybody want to say anything? I'll bring the mic around. Anybody want to say anything about that person who, or maybe it was people who invited you? Who was it that invited you? Something that inspired you? Somebody that showed you love? Anybody want to say? No, that's okay. But they're beautiful people, right? Some of them are in heaven. All those folks are in heaven, right? But they were the Andrews in our lives. But here's the thing. Don't jump the gun, right? Don't jump the gun. Because Andrew goes further than we're being asked to go now. Now, you can. But that's not what we have to. What does Andrew say? We found the Messiah. Now, how does he know that? Well, he knows it. God told him. But we don't have to say that. We don't have to go and say, hey, you've got to believe. You've got to be saved. No, that's not what this is about. For Back to Church Sunday, we're not really asking ourselves to do what Andrew did. At least not that part of it. All we're asked to do is bring someone to church, right? Invite someone to come to church. That's all we're asked to do, unless, of course, you want to, because that's what sharing your faith really is, right? It's about talking to folks about Jesus. It's about, you know, showing a deep concern. But what we're talking about is what would Jesus do, not necessarily what would Andrew do. So think about who you're going to invite. I want to take another moment here, because it's Back to Church Sunday, right? It's Back to Church Sunday. And who is it that you need to invite back, right? Who is it? I want to get real particular here. Who used to sit right here, right? Who used to sit in this pew? Who used to sit in this pew, right? And maybe they're with heaven. They're in heaven. They're with Jesus. Praise the Lord. But if they're not, if they're still here, and maybe they've moved away, right? They've retired and gone to Florida, whatever. Who used to sit here? Who used to sit in this pew right here? Right there. You folks, some of you know, some of you don't know. You've been here shorter time than I have been here. But who used to sit in the front pews? Those were the bold ones, right? Anybody that'll take the front pew, God bless them. You know, that's the place. But who can you invite? A couple of weeks ago, we were talking about somebody, Blackledge, I think it was a Blackledge, and they said, oh yeah, he just lives over there. You know, he's still in the neighborhood. He used to come to this church. He used to sing. He used to be active, but he's not here right now. But that doesn't mean he can't be, right? Invite him back to church, or her, or him, or them. the family, whoever it is, invite them back to church. You'll be glad you did. They'll be glad you did, right? It's back to church. It doesn't have to be someone that was here before, but if it is, think about it this way. What if you and I and three or four of us all went to the same person? What if, I'm not saying ganging up on them, we all show up on their doorstep. No, but what if we all, God puts on our hearts the same person? Would that person feel like, wow, they really love me there. They really want me there at that church. Yeah, I used to go to that church. I haven't been to church in a while, but they want me back. Wouldn't they feel that way? I think I would feel that way if people did that for me. And so it can be. We want you back. We miss you. We love you. But it also can be someone totally new, someone in your family, in your friendship, somebody that only you know. And they can be invited back as well. And you know who these folks are. Here's the key. You know who they are. I may not. But you do. And if you do, here's the burden that Christ puts on us. Because you know the person, God is saying to you, I want to use you to get him back to church. Yeah, the pastor should go too. But if the pastor doesn't know him, I mean, I'm just doing my job, and I'm not opposed to that, and I always do that. But is it someone that you have influence with? Think about that. Pray about that. Is it someone that you would be more successful in getting back than I would be? And I'll be glad to go with you. You know, that'd be great. So think about that. And then remember my dare from last Sunday. Not a dare. That's not a right word. My hope. Prove me wrong. When I said, you know, stupidly, I said, oh, I don't know that we'll ever fill this church again. Prove me wrong, right? I apologize. I shouldn't have said that. But prove me wrong. Faith the size of a mustard seed. That's all we need. Faith the size of a mustard seed. And see what God will do with you and that kind of faith. Amen? As we leave this place again today, remember, it's not about your confidence, right? Am I confident? Oh, Lord, I'm a little bit afraid. I'm a little bit afraid to talk to somebody, to invite them to church, or to talk to somebody about my faith. But it's not my confidence that matters, right? My confidence is not in my confidence. Where is my confidence? Right? It's in Him. And God will work miraculously through you as we are yielded to Him, as we are consecrated, just as we sing, unto the Lord. Go in His peace. Amen.